Praise God. Good morning, church. Let's give the Lord a clap offering first. We can do that. Our first Sunday back, it's actually quite emotional. It's so good to see you. And thank God that what the enemy might have meant for evil, God has meant it for good. We've come back and we're going to be stronger. And we're going to declare this morning that God is sovereign, that he's almighty, that he's all powerful, that he never changes, that he's the same today, yesterday, and forever. I want to thank God for each and every one of your lives, for ACC leadership. We've become stronger, we've stood strong, and I thank God for each and every one of their lives. Archbishop has given revelation after revelation from this pulpit throughout the lockdown, and today's going to be no different. We spoke early this morning and he said the Lord had him up all night, giving him revelations that he could not sleep. He was here before 7 o'clock, I think, this morning, preparing and getting it down. He was trying to get everything down that God had spoken to him last night. So we are a blessed generation. I feel so privileged to be in this church in a time such as this. So I want to really give God thanks this morning. The Shenis and Dominic and the whole team. You know when we say thank God for the team, there really is a team because we're united as ACC. So whether we were in our homes, and for the viewers that are home this morning, it's no different. God loves unity. And where there's unity of spirit, there is liberty. When we speak about the Holy Spirit bringing liberty, it's liberty in our spirits first and foremost. Because unless we are free, we can't preach freedom to someone else. So this morning as we come present, in his presence, let's receive what God has for us. And I'm gonna ask Shenis to minister the blessing. And many of you know how this blessing, the words of the blessing was Moses instructed. God spoke to Moses and instructed Aaron how to bless the people of Israel. And it's from Numbers 6:24. It's become so topical at this time. And in fact, I think it's the worship song of this season. And it says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And in Exodus 20 verse 5 says, showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. Deuteronomy 7, 8 to 9. Therefore know that the Lord your God, he is God. And that's why we're here this morning, because I know that God is God. And I know that he's faithful. And I know that he's unchanging. And I know that when the trials and the struggles in life come, and the storms come, he never changes. He's the solid rock beneath our feet. So be encouraged this morning. Be encouraged. You don't have to fight for your place. You don't have to fight for your future. God has won the race. God has fought for you. It's not whether there's a crack and an open door. We think that we've got to somehow stir up something within us to attain that blessing. God has given that blessing. God has died for you. He loves you with an abundant love that we cannot imagine. So don't think you need to strive. You need to rest. Rest in his blessing, rest in his grace, rest in his favor. He made a way for you where there was no way. He ran the race and he's completed that race. No one can take your place, church. You have a seat. You have a place in glory that he paid for. He paid it all. You're washed and you're cleansed and you're forgiven. Receive that blessing this morning, because the word's going to go out in power, because we're clearing the heavenly realms. And it's not by might and it's not by power. It is by his spirit. Sometimes we get so used to rhetoric in Christian churches. Rhetoric is just words. The scriptures, the Bibles, things we've learned. It's not what we know. Rhetoric. It's not how much scripture Archbishop has taught it week in and week out. It's how we live our lives. Plato once said, we can forgive a child who is afraid of the dark. The tragedy is when grown men are afraid of the light. And that is the reality. Let's not be afraid of the light. Do not be afraid of the truth, because the light and the truth is Jesus Christ, and He's your friend. He's the lover of your soul. He's your advocate. He loves you with an everlasting, amazing, abundant, overspilling love. So no matter how you feel this morning, because I know there are mixed emotions for many of us, this lockdown hasn't been good for all of us. But we are coming through. And the greatest blessings are reserved for those who have fought the hardest, strongest battles. Ye though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we are walking through. We are blessed and we are favored. Do not strive, do not struggle. Just rest in His love and His promises. And choose this day to bless Him. Choose this day to worship Him. Choose this day to follow Him. We are saved by grace, but changed by choice. We are saved by grace. Rest in that, but choose to follow. I'm going to hand over to Shenis, who's going to minister the blessing for us. You can stand. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. May His presence go before you, behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is for you. Receive the blessing of God this morning. God bless you.
Upon and a thousand generations. Praise God. Wow, it's a blessing to be here. Praise you, Lord. I'm going to lift up, stay amazed now, because we stand in awe of you, Lord, and we just can't get over how great you are. And it's just amazing to see everyone and to worship together in unity. Thank you, Lord.
God bless you this morning. It's wonderful to be with you once again, to be in the presence of God and to be able to lift up praise and worship this morning. We've got so much to be thankful for. The fact that we all woke this morning, that we could come into this house this morning to be together. We've got so much to be thankful for. I'm so glad that I woke up this morning and I came here.
Hallelujah.
And, amen. We can do better than that. Let's give the Lord a clap of praise. Amen. This is our time. This is our season. Amen. Thank you. Take your seats. We're going to move on to the next segment of our service this morning. We're going to take our offering. But before we do, I just want to read a psalm. Psalm 29. And it says, "Give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. Yes, the Lord splinters the cedars of Lebanon. He makes them also skip like a calf, Lebanon and Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord divides the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the deer gives birth and strips the forest bare. And in his temple, everybody says, glory. The Lord sat enthroned at the flood, and the Lord sits as king forever. The Lord will give strength to his people. The Lord will bless his people with peace." And, you know, that is so true. Everything that it says about the Lord is so true. We've witnessed that not just through lockdown, but even before. And we will witness that until the consummation of time. So, you know, we're going to take our offering now. And as you see, we're here functioning. And the church did not take time off when we were during lockdown. The church was busier than it has ever been. You know, the church has been going to the highway, the byways, reaching those that are lost. And that's what we're all called to do. And we're called to that physically, mentally, emotionally, but also with our finances. So as we take our offering this morning, just bear these things in mind and be blessed as you give. And when you take your offering, if you feel that you want to continue giving it electronically, you can do so through your mobile devices, or we have the offering basket and you'll be called row by row to come forward and put your offering in the basket here. So God bless you.
Miracles come, we need your super natural.
there, there's a stirring in the waters this morning. There's a bubbling over in my spirit for what we're going to receive. And it was a joy, actually. I've never felt that before, seeing all of you come and give your offering. I know we're doing it online and through our telephones here at the front. But it was a joy because you're invested in the kingdom of God. It was such a blessing to see you come one by one and give your offering. I want to thank God for your lives. And I'm going to invite Archbishop to share the word. I'm in so much anticipation, but also in fear and trembling for what comes from this pulpit. So let's prepare our hearts. I want to welcome Bishop Noel also in the house. Let's give the Lord a clap offering for his life. Amen. We're so excited to come to church. And Gary. God bless you, Gary. It's nice to see you. Won't be long now, Gary, when you can still come and sing a song. But for now, you have to be patient. And each and every one of you, and everyone represented, and family at home also. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that this truly is the day that you have made, and we can rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you for the offering. We thank you for our children, Lord. We thank you, Father God, that you have been with them through this time. We thank you for schools that are about to reopen. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are not absent from this situation. You are so present. I thank you for the word that will be ministered this morning. Thank you, Father God, for Archbishop. Lord, I pray that we will not take the gift that we have for granted. We are so thankful for your word. And as you minister this morning, Lord, soften our hearts that we may receive you once again and that you may become flesh within us. I thank you for every aspect of our lives. We give you the glory, the preeminence this morning, and we truly bow the knee of our hearts before you. Bind us together now as a church, those at home and those here present. Make us one as you and the Father are one. As the word is ministered, Lord, that we'll be one in spirit, one in accord, one in love. We give you glory in Jesus' name. The church say amen, amen, amen. Let's give the Lord a clap of faith. Thank you. And invite Archbishop to share the word this morning.
God bless you. Good morning. Praise the Lord. I'd ask you to hug each other, but it may not be appropriate this morning. The fact that we are here,
amen.
This is emotions of joy, not of any symptoms. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. It's good to be here by the grace of God. But before I come to the message, I just want to show you a little overhead, a little video, while I prepare my backdrop, because I want to just use the flip chart for some words to just share. So if I ask, while I do that, I'll ask Stubborn to just play the video for us. Praise God.
Very easy.
Very good. You're very good. It's not easy.
No,
thank you.
didn't know you were going to have an arts and crafts lesson this morning. Thank you. Well, you got the idea. We're going to the potter's house today, praise God, this morning. And we're going to look, delve into the depth, width, length and height of the mysteries of what's represented in the potter's house. Amen. We're going to turn to Jeremiah chapter 18. I'm not sure if you can see the writing at the back. It's quite faint, but I'll explain it. But I just put it there just to prompt us so we have some visual. Praise God. This is Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1. You can read it from on your overheads. The overhead is going to be on now. And I want just to be prayerful. Let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to give us a rich understanding. Welcome to the people watching live stream at home, and welcome everyone who's attending in attendance today. And our God's going to bless us. You know, I've been in preparation for a long time to just minister the word of God, praise God. And Joshua, when they were going to cross over the Jordan, it says he rose early. In Joshua chapter 3, it says Joshua rose early. I would have risen early if I had gone to sleep last night. So it's this continuation from Friday to me today to be here with you to share this message, a deep message, an encouraging message, an empowering message, an impacting message to help you on your spiritual journey. Because, you know, we are not just physical, but we're spiritual as well. We need spiritual nourishment to continue this journey to get us to where we need to be, praise God. So Joshua chapter 18, verse 1 reads as follows. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he was making, the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter? Says the Lord, look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. The instant I speak concerning the nation, a nation, and concerning a kingdom, to pluck up, to pull down, and to destroy it, if that nation against whom I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent of the disaster that I thought to bring upon it. And the instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to build and to plant it, if it does evil in my sight, so that it does not obey my voice, then I will relent concerning the good with which I said I would benefit it. Praise God. Thank God for his word. Amen. This is Jeremiah the prophet. So we look at some interesting insights as to what's happening, what the vision he actually sees. Amen. He sees he's called to go down to the potter's house. It begins as follows. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house. The implication to descend speaks of what's happening in the world. The potter's house is a representation of everything that's happening in the world. Going down is a negative in relation to spiritual growth. It's only positive when we go down and we humble ourselves, then we can be elevated. But when the prophet's instructed to go down, he's speaking, go down to the lower plane, the lower level, which implies the distance from God. Amen. As we're told in Luke chapter 10, verse 30, about the man, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And when he descends, that's where he falls among thieves. And he's beaten, he's stripped, and he's robbed, and he's left half dead, and so forth. And in fact, going down implies the world. In Genesis chapter 11, verse 7, we're told when man is trying to make a name for themselves or for himself, we're told that God, through divine counsel, discusses between the Godhead, and God makes this statement in Genesis chapter 7, verse 11, Genesis chapter 11, verse 7, come, let us go down there, and let us come, let us go down there and confuse their language. Let us go down. Descending has always a negative connotation. And in fact, the Lord came down in order that we can come up. He became poor, that we can become rich. He became weak, that we can become strong. And we often say that's the divine exchange. So we're looking at the potter's house at this particular moment. So as we read on, let me just move on to verse 3 and 4. It says this, "Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter." So the potter's doing something and something happens. The clay in the hand of the potter is damaged in some way. It's marred, as the scripture tells us. But we're told by verse 4 that the potter uses the same piece of clay, but changes it and makes it into another vessel that's pleasing to him. And that's indicative, that it points to the direction that to say that God is a God of restoration. As long as we remain in the hands of the Lord, he can restore us. In fact, the Greek says something interesting. I want to just do some biblical exegesis. In the Greek, if you go to the Septuagint chapter 18, verse 3 in the Greek, if you just scroll up, I'll read the translation for you. It says this, "And the vessel which he was making with his hands fell." It didn't say, "and the vessel he was making in his hand, he dropped it," fell. Sometimes when God is working with us, we resist him and we fall out of his plan and purpose. The important thing is to stay in the midst of his hands. Whatever, however challenging it is to be in the hands of the Lord, it's better to be in the hands of the Lord than the hands of the world. It's better to be in God, in Christ, than to be in the world and face all the adversities and all the challenges of the world. So it's interesting how the Greek phrases it. But the Greek also says that he's doing a work at the wheel. When God is impacting our lives, he's working on us. It's the work he's doing. And we are his workmanship. We need to remain in the hand of the potter that is able to change us, transform us, and make us what he wants us to be. In fact, in the beginning, when Adam was in the hand of God, when God was made, the hand of God is a metaphor that speaks about the purpose and will of God. It doesn't mean about a physical hand. It means to be in his will and in his purpose. Sometimes we fall out or we leave, we come outside of the will and purpose of God. And so we need to come back into the will. Coming back into the will and purpose of God is coming back in his hands. That's why Jesus said, "If it's possible, take this cup away from me." But he concludes and says, "But not my will, thy will be done." Your purpose, your hand, your purpose, the desire of your hand should be fulfilled. And so as long as we move in the direction where God is leading us, we are in his hand. We may not be physically, we may not say physical hand, but we're in his purpose and in his plan. And that's the best place to be. I want to encourage you there, praise God. That's why Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, he says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works." As he's working upon us to bring something good about us, we in turn reflect that goodness by our action, by our way of life. We do good works in the world. We're saved by grace, but our good works qualify that we are truly saved in him, praise God. Amen. The Apostle Paul speaks about the Corinthian church, Satan, that the Corinthian church were his work, that they were his work. He was working on them like the potter in the potter's house. We work on each other. We help each other grow and develop. And we want to bring the best out of each other, not the worst out of each other. Praise God. Hallelujah. And that's why the Lord says that he was working. When he came into the world, he was working like the potter was working. He was working in the world. The world is the potter's house. This is why in the Gospel of John chapter 9 verse 4 he says, "I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day." The night time is coming when no one can work. But at the consummation of time, the work concludes, it finishes. How you are, you know, when the potter, we saw the potter on the wheel working on the clay. As long as it's on the potter's wheel, it's supple and you can reform it. But if that clay vase or pot comes off the wheel and goes into the fire, it's set in its position, in its disposition, whatever. And so you can no longer mold it. So life has a tendency that the fiery darts of the enemy coming against it. If we don't have the shield of faith, we'll be set in the wrong way. And then we will be only good for the fire of God's rejection. But importantly, let's continually be on the potter's wheel in the potter's hands, and he can mold us. And if we err, if we go do it, something that's not right, God can always correct us and mold us and bring us back to where we need to be. Praise God. So we're told the vessel that was in made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. We often do things. We have an advocate, which is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, stands before the Father and intercedes for us, that we can become restored in ourselves, in Him, through our own attitude in God. So therefore, being in God's hand metaphorically means that you are in His purpose and you are in His will. We need to be careful we don't come out of that. It's like being an umbrella in a covering. You know, Psalm 91, all the blessings that follow in Psalm 91 are only subject conditional to being in that secret place. And when we're in the secret place, it's representative of the hands of the potter, that in the hands of the Lord, in that secret place. And I want to encourage you to be there. So I want to now next move on to the mystery of the will. And what's represented in the will? What's represented in the hand? Amen. And what's represented in the vessel? And I want to look at, that's why I've written these words on the backdrop here. Okay? The first word is havenim, that means that it's translated as a will. Havenim. It's made of a breaking up of a compound word, makes of a few words joined together. The che means the, avim means the will is translated. But in fact, the proper translation is havenim, that means the stone. Lithos, the stone. So we have to be on this stone. When you take the though away, avim is a collective noun. I'm telling you from Bible exegesis here. It's a collective noun. And it works in the same way as this word at the bottom here, which is found in Genesis chapter 1, Elohim. Any word that finishes with im is a collective noun, meaning it's got plural implication, but it's a singular word. For example, the word team, T-E-A-M, is team is a singular word, but it means many parts to it. Army, it's not armies with the S, it's army is a singular word, but it has many parts to it. And the word ha-venim works in the same way. It should be translated English as stone, not stones, or will, not wheels, because it's collective noun, because that's how in Genesis the word Elohim is translated. It's not translated in the beginning the gods created the heavens and earth, because embodied in the Elohim is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's tripartite, but it has a singular meaning because it's one nature. Okay, watch this. I'm taking you somewhere. Watch this. If we go to here, if we go to Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 3, I've been very sensitive for the ones watching live as well. Please just follow us, make your notes, because my messages are quite deep. So you need to go back over them. It requires that you use your brain. Sometimes our brains are switched off. We need to switch our brains back on. So we know the truth, and the truth can set us free. It says this, in the New King James, watch what it says here. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something on the stone, it should say. But it says will, singular. But the old King James translates it slightly differently. If we go to the authorized version very quickly, the original King James, have you got it there? And watch what it does here. This is what I'm saying. This is why we have to go to the original to understand what God is saying to us if we're teaching the Word of God. Have you got it? If we go to the original King James. It says, then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. Big difference between plural and singular. Because they don't know how to handle that. They don't know how to handle a collective noun, the Hebrew, the him. Any word that finishes him is a collective noun. It's a singular word with a plural meaning to it. So that sometimes they don't know, when they speak about the heathen gods, and they use Elohim for a heathen god, they count it the gods. But when they're using for the God of creation, the Yahweh, they say God. So we've got to be consistent in understanding things of God. There's no problem to think of the heathen gods as Elohim as singular, because they're not the true God. It's Elohim, the Yahweh God, that is the true God, the revelation of God. Anyway, I just want you to hold on to that thought just for a few moments. Okay, now, if we draw these three, if we take the plural out, just draw these three letters here and put them down here. I've already done it for you. I don't know if you can see there. Let me just move it forward. Here, these three letters, Avim means stone. Okay, means stone. I want you to think about that just for a moment, Avim. So he says, I went to the potter's house and there he was making something at the wheel. Okay? And he says, making something at the stone. Okay? Avim means stone. This stone is mystical. This stone is not a normal stone. It's not the potter house. Does not represent a physical potter's house. It implies a spiritual disposition, a spiritual, there's a spiritual dimension to it. And in that potter's house, which is a spiritual, must have a spiritual stone represented in that house. And so when David was going to go against Goliath, he had to go into the potter's house and get this stone and take it and use that stone to defeat Goliath. Watch this carefully. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 49 says this. Then David put his hand in his bag. See, the bag is a symbol of the potter's house, and took out a stone. Avim took out the same word, which is in Jeremiah, Avim, and slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank in his forehead, and he fell on his face to the earth. If you want to overcome your demonic powers, your temptations, you need to draw from the stone, Avim, the stone, okay, whatever's represented in that stone, because Psalm 118 says, the Avim, that the builders rejected, became the chief cornerstone that the house of God is built upon. So we need to draw from this Avim now. So it's on the Avim that we are reformed. When we're marred, we can only be reformed on the Avim, the stone, which the builders rejected. It's the will that refines us, transforms us, and makes us what God wants us to be. The world cannot do that for you. Watch this. Let's just praise God. And it's the same stone that when King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had the dream of the big giant statue, the figure, it says he saw an Avim, a stone carved with no hands, representing the virgin birth, was taken from the stone, from this rock, from the mountain, and slung, propelled at the statue figure, the idol, at the feet, and destroyed the power of every kingdom that opposes God. It was the Avim, which is the stone representing Christ. Okay. Hallelujah. Praise God. Something more important is on the Avim, Ha-Avim, that the Hebrew women bore their children in Egypt. In Exodus chapter 1, verse 16, watch this, it says this. And he said, when you do the duties of midwife for the Hebrew women, see them on the birth stool. The Hebrew word for birth stool is ha-navim. When you see them on the ha-navim, because in Christ we birth the virtues. He says, kill every male child, kill the virtues. The devil wants to destroy whatever's produced by your relationship with the stone, the rock, the stone that the builders rejected, the enemy doesn't like. Takes vengeance against and wants to destroy, comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But Moses was born on the Anavim and was taken and was nursed because the woman, his mother represents the church. And it's in the church, it's the potter's house that nurtures us. I wish I'm speaking to someone today to help us move on. Now, this is very important, this is because God embodies his revelation in a word, conceals it. And at appropriate time, he reveals it to us. That knowledge will increase. You're never going to hear this message, but you can go to any Bible commentary. You will not find this message I preach to you today. I can guarantee you, if you find me a book, a scholar, a prophet, a preacher, preaching the message today, you come and tell me. You're not going to find this. Let me take you deeper. This word, Avim, embodies the Godhead. How? If you take the Aleph and Beth, and it saves the word Av. The word Av means father. If you take, remove the Aleph and use the Beth and the Nun together, it says Ven, which son. Father and son is the one, is what builds and develops you and restores you and makes you another vessel, a new creation, that everything old pass away and everything becomes new. What do I mean by this? Watch this. And it's in the hand of the potter. The potter's hand. And what does the potter's hand is a representation of the presence of God. When Samuel was going to anoint Saul as king over the first king of Israel, we're told when he was anointed that the Holy Spirit came upon him, he became another vessel, another man. In 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 6, it says this: then the Spirit of the Lord came upon you, and then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you, and you will prophesy with them and be turned into another man, praise God. God wants to do something new in us. He wants to make something different, but we have to be situated in the potter's house, on the ven, on the havaven, havavim, of the presence of God's presence, praise God. And nobody, watch this, nobody can snatch you out of his hands. There's no power. You can be wherever you are geographically, makes no significance, no difference with the things of God, your relationship with God. Wherever you, does not matter. It doesn't imply closeness or distance from God. It's your attitude, your desire that determines how close you are to God and how far away you are from God. I wish I'm speaking to someone. In John chapter 10, verse 28, watch this, says this: and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. This is for you, church. You will never perish. The devil has no power to destroy you unless you give him, unless you entertain his imaginations. Yeah? When you have your shield of faith, it will quench the fiery darts of any thought that come against you. God, you in faith in God will bring it down, praise God. That's why Paul tells the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3, this is what he says. He says, and I want you to embrace this as you move on through this period in our life. This is a new chapter for the church, a new walk in the church. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Verse 4 says this: for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Amen. Amen? And what's a stronghold? The warfare in your mind. Watch this. Verse 5 says this. It says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. It's what's happening in your mind. The enemy wants to take captive of your mind. And when he takes captive of your mind, he wants to penetrate your church, your heart, filter down into your heart, take control of you, and lead you direction where he wants you to go, to take you out of the potter's hand and the potter's wheel and the potter's rock, stone, praise God. Hallelujah. So we need to stand firm with our faith in God. That's why Jesus says, and I will give them eternal life.
Yes.
And they shall never perish. You're not destined to perish. Your portion is not to perish. Your portion is to rise and be more than a conqueror, praise God. No weapon fashioned against you shall prosper. And every tongue that rises against you will be cut off. Any criticism against you, God will cut it off. Any accusation against you, God will cut it off. God will set you free. The sun sets you free. You are truly free. Watch this, watch this. Neither should anyone snatch them. Out of my hand. The potter's hand. Then he says this: my Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. Watch this, watch, watch. Father, Son. You establish there. No one, when you're in there, he'll renew you. He'll remake you, he'll restore you. He will atone there in the potter's house. You become that new creation in him. And no one can change, no one can impact unless you give a window, unless you give an opening. No air, no weapon, no device of the enemy can penetrate and the fortification that you have in the Father and in the Son. Otherwise, God would not be God. Oh. And then he concludes in verse 13 and says, I and my Father are one. I want to say that again. I and my Father are one. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Hallelujah. That the church is built upon. Praise God. Another title that Jesus has is rock. So we have a stone and we have a bedra. Lithon and bedra. We have the stone and we have the rock. And we're told, the word of God tells us, that the rock that followed them was Jesus Christ. So these are all metaphors, all images, all allegories, all symbols representing the presence of God in our lives, praise God, hallelujah. This is why we're told in the Corinthian church, chapter 10, verse 4, says this. And all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Very interesting, that rock was Christ. If you go into Exodus chapter 17, verse 6, it's this. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And this is the reference that Paul has. He's looking to this rock, that they all drank from this rock, that satisfied, quenched their spiritual thirst. For Israel, in the old Israel, it was limited. For us, it's unlimited. Jesus said to the Samaritan, if you take off this water, you will never thirst again. You'll quench your thirst. God is there to satisfy us, satisfy our curiosities, our desires in the Lord, praise God. He's there to satisfy us, praise God. And so the word used here in rock there, that's the word rock, and Jesus is the rock. And the rock, the Greek word for the rock is bedra, okay? Interestingly, the stone, which is also the rock, Jesus said to Peter, Simon by Jonah, he said to him, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. In fashions have come and gone. We've seen many things through history. The church has always weathered it and come through. Amen. Amen. Every setback is a setup for God to do amazing things in and through our lives. Praise God. Hallelujah. When the Israelites left Egypt and they came to the bank, the east bank, to cross over, all the old generation had died, because the old generation means the old man. That was the marring part in the potter's house. The old man was marred. And God has to make from the old a new creation, a new man, praise God. And he says to them, I want you to make flint knives, he said. Flint knives, he said, to circumcise the people. The Greek word and the Hebrew word for flint knife is make knives out of the rock. It's Christ who circumcises our hearts now. I don't want to get too deep with the message, but I just want to just keep it. It's the first Sunday back, and I don't want to blow your minds today, praise God. And then we read on, once he sees these visions, and I've revealed what this vision represents, it's in Christ that we are renewed, it's in Christ that we are made, it's in Christ that we stand, the rock of our salvation, that's who we stand on. Anything else in the world is sinking sand. All our ambitions, all our dreams, all our hopes, and all our aspirations, if they're just worldly material, they're limited, they're fleeting, they're passing by, but it's only in Christ. He says, I give them eternal life. And no one can snatch them out of my hand. It's forever. It's not temporal. It's not for a limited time. It's unlimited. It's not a limited company with God. It's unlimited company. Do we have any unlimited companies in the world? It's unlimited. And then we're told in verse 5, Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 5. Watch this. And the Lord comes to speak to Jeremiah. He speaks to him initially, and he comes again to speak to him and changes everything. He says in Jeremiah 18, verse 5. So. He comes to him and speaks to him again. He says to him, then the word of the Lord came to me saying, he says, and the word came to him saying, came to me and saying, telling me, the word, you know, it's powerful. The word of God is still coming today, speaking to you. It's the word of God coming today, speaking into your lives, praise God. There's power in the word. There's liberty in the word. Psalm 119, verse 105 says this, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. If you are in darkness, the word will illuminate, disperse the darkness, and show you, pave the way forward, that show you the direction that you will go to avoid the lamb, the minefields of the world and of the enemy, praise God. His word, he says here, is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. And the fact that you navigated here today, God was the lamp and light to you, praise God. His word establishes you. We're told not only is his word a light, but his word brings healing. And I'm saying for the people watching, looking, seeing at home, whatever's going on in your life personally, whatever with family, emotion, whatever's going on, the word of God can bring healing, bring peace and comfort into your life, consolation into your life. Whatever your challenges we've experienced the past few weeks, the past few months, God's word can change everything. At his word, everything is transformed. It says in Psalm 107 verse 20, he sent his word, it says, and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. And it's his word that can deliver us, praise God, and get us to our destination, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It's better than the raw mail.
Yes.
Sometimes the raw mail has offsites, off days, but the Lord is 100%. His track record is 100% in getting us to where we need to go. The centurion knew this mystery. He knew that he had an insight to something divine, because when he approached the Lord, he said, just say the word. You don't have to come. Just speak your word will go forth and execute that which is sent out to do, and it will not return void. He knew his word has the power to heal and speak healing over your life. Even in your own cross, you don't need anyone to pray for you. You pray for yourself. Put your hands on your head and say, Lord, heal me. Lord, bless me. Lord, encourage me. Lord, prosper me. Lord, open the doors that no one can close, and close the door that no one can open. Lord, I need your word at this time in my life to change everything. I need your word to see clearly, praise God. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. He says, because at the entrance of his word gives light. When his word comes into our life today, you are being illuminated. See, the prophecies are mysteries, hidden mysteries in dark places. It's the illumination of Christ that gives clarity to these words. I can assure you that if you study these words without prophetic insight or visionary insight, you never understand, decode what's written in the word, how these things work. It's only in his word brings light and disperses the darkness of our ignorance that we see his word as he wants to reveal it to us. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, the word of God has power.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The word of God can change everything.
Amen.
Can change a situation.
Praise God.
You know, when you speak to someone, if you speak positive words to people, usually they lift their countenance. Is that right? Encourages them. When you speak negative, it brings them down. So the implication is this: stay away from people who speak negativity. You want your spirit lifted? Be around people who encourage you. I'm not saying about false flattery and patting on the back and all this puffing up. I'm talking about true, lovingly speaking love into your life, encouragement into your life, prosperity into your life. Not just physical, but spiritual at the same time. And you will overcome. You will move forward.
Yes,
hallelujah. Amen. One good word is better than 100 negative words.
Amen.
So stop listening to the wrong words. That's what Paul says. I'd rather speak 5 words of my understanding in church than 1,000 words in an unknown tongue. I want to speak things that people understand to edify them. And I pray the word today is edifying you. The word of God transforms. Hallelujah. It transforms us. This is the word that brought creation about. In John chapter 1 verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. This is the word that became flesh. In John chapter 1 verse 14, the word became flesh and we beheld his glory. This is the word which is the stone in the potter's house. It's the word of God, shaping us, transforming us, making us all that he wants us to be, praise God. And so the potter's house is representative of the world. But before the potter's house can be established in the world, the owner of the house, the potter's house, the owner who had rights to the potter's house, first had to be bound. Because the world and all the power, everything, the glory of the world belonged to, had the devil had rights. He didn't create it, but he had rights over it. So before the Lord can establish the true potter's house, he had to bind the one who was the keeper of the potter's house, the demonic powers, and everything that's represented in that. So this is why the Lord tells us, before you can take got into the strong man's house, you first have to bind him. And so the Lord bound him in order so he can work on us in the potter's house. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 29, this is what the Lord tells us. Oh, how can one enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds a strong man and then he will plunder his house? So the Lord came to bind the strong man. He who was binding us, held us captive, has become captive. And what he had captive, what the captivity he had, the ones who were in captivity, now have been set free. And if the Son sets you free, you are truly free indeed. Praise God. I want to really encourage you that now we are the vessel. God is transforming us. You are a different person. Have a different outlook. Have a different attitude. Have a different walk. Listen to things in a different way. Close your ears to the negative. Open them to the positive. Because he's invested the heavenly treasure in your vessel. Oh, come on. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 6 says this. For it is the God who in commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. You see, Father, Son, blah, 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 and the power of the Holy Spirit covering envelope. And watch this. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. You are the vessels in the potter's house, and he's pouring in, he's made you, but he's made you for a purpose. If you make a vase, the vase is made for, some people look at use it as decoration. But more or not, you do something with the vase, don't you? You hit each other over the head with it. Do you? No. You put flowers in it. But some people, some, I won't mention, they throw vases at each other. Look at these things, crack. Well, in the Old Testament, you'd see Gideon was told to smash the clay vase. Yeah, smash the clay vase. In fact, the Lord says on that stone, he goes, the stone that the builders rejected, if you break, you fall and break on it, you can be restored. But if it falls on you, grind you to powder, it says. So we need to first break the old man and rise in the new person. Yes. Amen. Praise God. So he says, vessel, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. So the implication is this heavenly treasure in us means power. Hallelujah. Power. Dynamis working in us and through us and impacting not just ourselves but our surroundings. God is able to change our surroundings. And he says, even though we are hard pressed on every side and yet not crushed, he says, we're not crushed. We are perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed. Whatever comes against us, we'll always weather it and rise above it and prevail. Praise God. That's what it's about. So I want to leave these few thoughts with you today. Just the image of the potter's house and you in the loving embrace, the loving hands of the Lord. And that potter's house is all representative of many different things, but most importantly, it implies relationship, and the onus is on us to remain there, because God doesn't keep you there without your will by force. He invites us to stay with him in his loving embrace. And once we're there, nobody can snatch you out of his hands, praise God. Amen. Psalm 91, I want to finish on this psalm as a prayer for you. We began this lockdown with this psalm, and now we're coming through it. I want to close with this psalm. 91, it says this. And how will you just embrace this? I want to read this as a prayer for all of us. And this is your portion, please. And the people at home, this is your portion. No one is excluded. Just because you couldn't make it here, it doesn't mean you're excluded from the blessings today. And if you're watching this later on, as recorded, you're still being blessed because the word has its power, praise the Lord. I had a call, one of my bishops called me early this morning from across London, and he said to me, Bishop, is it okay, can we allow people to take communion in their homes? And I said to him, yeah, well, what do you mean? He goes, you know, can they get wine and bread and say, yeah, because as long as you're giving the covering and you're officiating that, yes, you can. He says, and I explained to him, look, I said, we don't sanctify the bread and the wine. We don't. Doesn't matter our position. It's God who does that. So if I give that authority for the prerogative I have in the Lord and say, people are at home, take your bread, take your wine and join in with us, and I bless it. God is not limited by space. God is not limited through the channels, the media, television. God fills all things. So when we're praying, the same anointing that's here is there in your homes. And so when we pray for the bread here, he extends to you. If that cannot happen, we're not serving a true living God. And what's happened is the same way David, when he was in, he and his men were hungry, they went into the temple and they took the shortbread that was for the Levites. But they ate it, and it was only for the priests, it wasn't for the king, because the kings and priests had different roles and different functions, different modes of function. But yet, because of hunger, because of the need, transcended the rule. In the same way, you're driving down the road, and someone gets hit by a car, there's double yellow line, are you going to say, well, I can't park this, and drive off? You don't. The need of the individual, the person, is more important than the double yellow lines. So you've got to get out and help the person. That's what's important. The person made in the image of likeness, not the yellow lines that you can paint all over the place. That's insignificant. And that's what's important, is that it's God who sanctifies, not us. We create the environment and we release the blessing, but it's God who blesses ultimately at the end. Praise God. So just bear these things when you do things. Be careful, become too legalistic and rigid and closing God in a box. He's had enough of being in the Ark of the Covenant behind the curtains. He wants to break out and come and meet you in the place where you are. And he already did that, the cross of Calvary. He surrendered to from top to bottom to step out to meet us. And if he's met us, why have we rejected him and just confined things to human limitations? We need to let God be who he is in and through our lives. So I want to pray Psalm 91 as a prayer. And then we're going to come to the Lord's table. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Verse 2. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you should take refuge. His truth should be your shield and buckler. You should not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it should not come near you. Only with your eyes you should look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. I want to just leave it there. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we pray for this word. We pray that we are established in your potter's house, in your protection, fortified by your loving embrace. Bless every person here in this room. Bless the people who are watching live stream at home. And may whatever we do prosper and be fruitful. Keep us well. Safeguard people, Lord, from any virus, any situation, spiritual or natural. Release your blessing, your healing, your power, your anointing. Give peace, bring joy, because the joy of the Lord becomes our strength. I release the blessing, patriarchal blessing, apostolic blessing onto everyone who hears it, who is at the end of my voice now. You're blessed and you're highly favored. From the crown of your heads right through to the sole of your feet, you are favored, you are loved. Not just philola, but agabi love in the Lord. We give the Lord the praise, the glory, and the worship we say together resounding. Amen. 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 God bless you. You are loved and highly favored. Praise the Lord. Amen. If you have any questions, please, you can ask, communicate with us later on. I just want to make you aware how we're going to officiate the communion along according to government guidelines, but nonetheless, we're doing the right things. We're going to pray together now. Then we're going to put the communion down there in front, and row by row, you'll be directed to come. The bread is in the, I'll take my one, is in the actual wine. So you just take this with you, you go back to your seats, just take it, go to your seats, and then we'll take it all together, okay? As I say, when, and then we're going to have disposal, we're going to have where you can dispose of the cups and so forth. So we pray together. Amen. As they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, broken, and gave to the disciples and said, take heed, this is my body. Then he took the cup up and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Amen. Can the stewards help row by row to come forward? Praise the Lord. Amen. Are you blessed to be here?
Amen.
I think everyone has done well this morning, first day back as a church. God bless you. It's good to see you. We've missed you all dearly. I thank everyone who's been involved today and the people watching at home soon. I pray that things will change and everyone in the church will start coming back to some type of normality. But God bless you. I've been richly blessed this morning to have been with you all. It makes a difference speaking just to a camera. Speaking to myself. It seems like that sometimes, but it doesn't matter. Praise the Lord. I have a party all by myself sometimes. Praise the Lord. God bless you. We're going to have a closing praise. Yes? Amen. Who do I give over to? The senior pastor. Come say a few words if you want, and then praise the Lord. God bless you. You are loved.
Praise God, church. Thank you, Archbishop, for that amazing word. We're going to close in our final song. What should we do, Don? We do something different? What should we do?
Hear my cry.
Hear my cry.
Bind us together.
Andy, it will be bind us together. In fact, I will lead it. I won't even ask her. We'll do two songs. Praise. It's so good having you lot in the house. Because there's a difference. It's living and live, and we're united, and we can overrule Bishop sometimes. Let's stand together. Let's do bind us together, and then Dominic, I'll give it over to Dominic to finish. Thank God for our Sunday service, for Archbishop, for the word. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful this day that you do hear our cry, Lord. I thank you, Almighty God, for the word that's gone out in power today. Lord, that you may bind us together with cords of love that can never be broken. And I pray for the rest of our church family. I've had so many messages, those who are actually, there's some struggles, some sicknesses, some situations. But the word has gone out in power today, and we can find everything we have need of is in the word of God. And I do pray for those who are at home at the moment and are sick. We pray truly that he sends his word and heals that disease. Amen. There's going to be so many announcements because God is doing new things in the midst of us. Church, there's revival. Archbishop got a word prophetically that there is revival for our ACC. And each one of us has to take our place now and be ready. Because our hearts, we need to let down the nets of our hearts for the newness to come in. So be a part of what God is doing. Again, I really want to thank the leadership of this church, every single one of them who stands and labors behind the scenes. We know that we all partake of what God is doing in our lives. For Archbishop, we've thanked him. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Truly, thank you. Continue to honor those who labor in word and doctrine. And there's going to be something new that I will be doing. And God's been speaking to me continually, and Archbishop has confirmed it, that I'm going to begin again to do some ladies' seminars and conferences. Did that. That's how the ministry began, praise God, many years ago. And it was at my house every Wednesday, and all the women would come together, and I would teach, and I'm going to teach. And God has given me the name, and it's rubies. Think about what rubies represent. Wisdom and godliness and character and value, rarity. It's rare in this world to have wisdom. Bishop often says about common sense, and he carries on to say that unfortunately common sense is not common. But we have the wisdom of God, the Sophia. So we want to thank God for the revelations that have been ministered this morning. The rock of our salvation. What are we going to do? Bind us together. Hallelujah.
Love of God permeates you.
For thou hast been a shelter for me. Shall follow us through the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever. Let's give him a mighty clap of the Lord bless you. Now, don't get too excited. You're going to have to be led out orderly. So take your seats. God bless you, and see you next week.